introduce you to my colleagues at my office. This is Paul, Said, Karen, Klaus, and Ulla sitting in this relatively newly refurbished building in central Copenhagen, the Confederation of Danish Industries. It's a really centrally located building on the Town Hall Square. And as you see, it has this double glazing facade with these diagonal window panes. And it's situated right on the border between the Town Hall Square and the Tivoli Garden, so it's a really fantastic place in the city. It's state-of-the-art, totally fully glazed building, and as you can see, you have this central atrium there where you have solar panels on the roof and you have solar shading integrated in the glazing. So you have employed, every trick of the trade to create a, contemporary smart building. One of the things that happened in the construction process was that this is actually reusing the concrete structure of the previous building, which was a 70s office building with deep floor plans and so on. Relatively low ceiling heights, so we still have that. But it obviously saved a lot of carbon emissions due to not having to reproduce all this concrete structure. And I think that's sort of the first step into a smart building, that you actually begin to reuse materials as part of the equation. It also has this terrific roof garden facing the Tivoli Gardens, and I can say that it's definitely one of the most delightful aspects of the building, that you have these amenities and also a big atrium where you used to celebrate sort of the champions of Danish design, young students, coming up with innovative ideas and so on. But let's return a little bit to how it is to actually work in the building, because indoor environment is it's good. There's lots of daylight. And I suppose the exchange is fine, but it's awfully dry, and the ceiling is not that high. So sometimes the building just does not really work with the outdoor conditions, just slightly, but enough, to be discomforting. And you can't open the windows, so you can't adjust humidity. And you can't adjust, when you need some fresh air. And I think this is one of the sort of deficiencies of contemporary design that we will need to work on in the future, that you simply as a user don't have enough control of the comfort that the space provides. And that is really a crucial aspect that we need to address as designers, as architects and engineers, to give back some of the control to the users of the building. Nothing happens. It doesn't go back, it doesn't go forward. I have lost control. The laser thing works. Well, if you can shift manually, I'll just say shift or tap the table or try to command, Yeah, is it the architecture or is it the technology that's failing here? We'll see. Well, good. I think that this was sort of the critique that Rem Koolhaas actually addressed. When he did this installation at the Venice Biennale 4 years ago on the exhibition called Elements, and what you see here is actually the juxtaposition of today's engineering versus yesterday's architecture. And so we see, you have this low ceiling on hanging under this splendid dome, you know, with frescoes of mythological scenes or whatever it is, and you have this just juxtaposition of architectural ways of dealing with the environment and sort of the storytelling narrative of the architecture, and the sort of the cold engineering behind it. Is, you know, you can interpret this in a, you know, in a lot of ways, but is sort of the engineering sort of stealing the image here? Is that really the question here? Why don't we see sort of an architectural approach to this? I think this comes from Rem Koolhaas' earlier observation that modern office buildings were really striped like zebras, meaning that every floor plan is not only the layer that you need for the construction, but you have an additional cavity, you know, supposed to house all the ventilation ducts and installations for the building, and that actually accounts for a lot of the volume of the building. Why not use that volume for something fun? You know, that's the first impression. But why not do away with it? That could be the sort of the second question, which is what Baumschlager Eberle did with the 2226 building, that is sort of a critique of modern HVAC systems that has been done away with entirely in this building. This is a totally passive building that says, well, why can't the design do all climatization of the building? It's a heavy thermal mass building. It's very well insulated, and the only heat sources are actually the bodies of the people and the equipment in this space. So there's a lot of engineering here, but it's engineering without the engines, as Bjarke Ingels might say. And the architecture actually takes responsibility for the climatization of the project. This is sort of the complete other end of the spectrum, where technology, particularly HVAC technology, is minimized totally, and the building's shape and design is in charge. I think we can do with other, you know, approaches with this, where architects and engineers actually work together, as they have done for quite some time with Henning Larsen Architects, a Danish design company that simply built up an engineering capacity over the last decade, a little bit more than a decade. And they sort of integrate engineering in the design process. So every little step of the design process, you would look into the spatial configuration and the choice of materials, and you would save energy step by step. So, and of course, you know, focusing totally on that this should be a vibrant space that defines a community where, you know, people are visible, where you have ways to share knowledge. This is a university campus, and also to concentrate when working. So there are all sorts of devices from the urban level, the shape of the building, the orientation of the building, the way that the design is the facade design is shaped, and they all add up to energy savings and producing a benign indoor environment in this building with, as you can see, lots of daylight, lots of transparency, lots of contact with nature, and lots of ways to meet. So they work with this architectural engineering philosophy that the first thing you should do would actually be to reduce the energy demands. Then you can begin to optimize the building and the systems, and then and only then you begin to actually add solar cells and other ways of applying renewable energy. So you minimize the need for technology, for sophisticated technology, and you let the architecture actually take most of the responsibility. So this approach is beginning to become more mainstream among Danish architects, and I think that also among engineers, this is beginning to become part of the philosophy that we, of course, it should be, of course, we don't design to save energy. We design, you know, for the purpose of serving people's needs, as Dan, you said in the first place. So you also see a shifting focus that it used to be all, sustainability equals energy savings, and now we say, well, that's fine. We are actually in control, sort of relatively well, of that. Why not actually look at the social value and any economic benefits that you might also include when you work with more dimensions of value? So we're beginning to develop this sort of idea of looking more into what are actually the benefits that come out of architecture. There's sort of a resource management aspect, and that is of course where energy is addressed. It's of course also about costs, you know, economic costs, environmental costs, and so on. But if we really begin to focus on the values that we produce, sort of environmental qualities, and the social benefits that come out from having a great design, that might even produce some economic values that are much higher than the initial investment in the building. One case, we're looking into cases, you know, where we've documented 75 cases at the Association of Danish Architectural Firms, and I'll present a couple of them. that are sort of addressing different aspects of value creation here. And this is sort of, again, the same approach as you would see with Baumschlag Eiffel. This is a completely passive building because they did away with the climate system. It's not, there's no heating here, there's no cooling, because this is a sports facility, and why not actually, you know, make a dynamic building that actually does exchange with the outdoor conditions to some degree. That's the lighting, but still, you know, if you reinterpret the program and how you deal with it, you can actually produce a building that's totally usable, you know, provides not the same technical comfort, but, you know, comfort that's great enough for the activities happening in this hall. And since they've also been working with, principles such as design for disassembly, circular economy, prefabrication, you know, they've been driving down the cost, you know, a lot. And this building is even, you know, they do life cycle assessments, life cycle costing as part of the design, integrated into the design process. So you can see, you can actually deliver a carbon neutral building using just reinterpreting the design philosophy here. And over the life cycle of this building, it would cost, you know, 80% less than you know, normal sports facility. but also, if you take more conventional programs, this is again a university campus for students. It's sort of a both a meeting space designed by Christensen and co-architects. At the DTU, the Danish Technical University, for the math, the computations students. So it's sort of integrating sort of hangout facilities for the students where they can do group work and meet up informally and so on, and you have also offices. But this building actually uses a complex shape of the atrium where they've planted trees to actually stabilize the humidity and the temperature within the atrium. The building is naturally ventilated, but with heat recuperation. That's sort of a system that that the engineers at the DTU devised for this project. And so it become a demonstrator that you can actually produce a low energy, very low energy building that is completely naturally ventilated. Most of the year. There's a little bit of mechanical ventilation in some of the offices. Again, you can do a lot with retrofitting. This is a project in central Copenhagen, 120, 30-year-old building, a building for housing, where they added rooftop apartments. that's good if you're a commercial house owner, because these penthouses have, you know, lots of access to views and daylight and so on, and that's so valuable that they can actually pay for the entire retrofitting of this project. And again, the architects allied themselves with researchers from the DTU, and they've been monitoring the both the use of energy here and the and the humidity in the constructions, because this is an insulation that's placed on the inside of the old facades, so you really have to monitor actually how the build the humidity might build up in the construction. This is really a strong risk factor when you retrofit old buildings. So that is monitored here. And so you have this this entire retrofit that's actually paid for by the rooftop apartments. And the real energy savings are a little bit more than half what used to be the case for this building. So, well, a substantial energy savings, but not exactly, you know, what was calculated, because that would be 75%. So this building, even with all the technology installed and a great business case and good facilities, these rooftop terraces are actually for all the tenants in the building. We still have this performance gap that Judith was addressing. That, well, it should have been 75%, but it is, well, more or less 50%. And this is really an image or a trend that we do notice and that researchers notice in the housing stock. People, well, the high-tech buildings underperform, but the actual old buildings where people used to pull out a jumper when it was cold, they actually perform much better than the calculated energy use of it. So there is again, as Dan said initially, there's simply a gap between the calculated and the real energy use here. And we need to address how people actually behave and the user's psychology if we need to improve that. And that's maybe an agenda for the high-tech solutions. I also think that when we begin to discuss what is a smart building, actually, well, it's become sort of a relatively narrow discussion of building automation, and perhaps, you know, how the building might be a storage for district-level energy flows, or how you can sort of micromanage a lot of energy flows on the district level. But I think that a smart building, it also should, you know, indicate that you need to be smart about how you actually manage energy in the design, and it should actually also include other factors such as actually addressing carbon emissions. I suppose that with the revision of the EPBD, I mean, the end goal in 2050 is decarbonized building stock. So in order to achieve that, we also need to look into circular economy. And this is a project, a single family house at a modest price, you know, ordinary market prices in Denmark, which is only using recycled materials, and there's a philosophy and a way to actually recycle all materials in the building again after this building might be demolished in the future sometime. So it's a totally circular philosophy, and this is a building that is, you know, at basic costs, and it's exactly as energy efficient as any other, you know, new build Danish single family house at no extra cost. But you, as you can see, we are very close to actually achieving sort of the decarbonized building stock here by the design philosophy alone. So I think that this kind of thinking, this life cycle thinking, is really necessary to add on as a level to the discussion about what a smart building would be. And the problem about this is, how do you actually manage all these resources invested into buildings over the long term of a building's life cycle? Maybe when you talk about digital twins, I mean, we do almost one-to-one models when we design buildings. We need to actually add on a building material passport as a way to document the resources that are actually invested in the building so that they can be reused in the future. That is also a way to think smart, I think, about buildings. This case is, a new building, education facility for unemployed people who need basic further education so that they actually qualify sort of for the levels of competences that you need to have in order to get a job. The client's brief to this design was that this building must not look anything like a school, because these people, they have usually had a bad time at school. So we don't want any classrooms. We don't want any back rows where you can sit and hide, and so on. We want an open environment where people feel invited, where they feel appreciated, where they can find, spaces that are good when you do concentrated work, and where you can actually also meet informally and exchange ideas and so on. So that's the brief behind this open plan school, or sort of professional school it is. In the town of Åbenrå, designed by Art Architects. And as a design topology, you could find this in many ways. It's totally related to the Culling campus that I showed you previously by Henning Larsen Architects. But what they did, Art Architects, was to actually go back to the site, not only to monitor whether the building was, technically correct. It is a low-energy building, like any other. But the aspect here was, how do people actually appreciate this building? And do they appreciate the design features? And do they experience the amenity of the space in the great endeavor of actually learning things? And what they discovered was that doing sort of an anthropological study was that this was really highly appreciated by the students and the staff. And they said, this is a building that motivates us. And that's, of course, great. But when you actually add the numbers, that this building actually began to achieve higher exam completion rates and a much higher rate of students that actually continued their education in order to qualify for a job. And since in this particular case, this is unemployed people become on the path to becoming taxpayers. You can see, there's sort of a societal cost of 17,000 euro a year in benefits being converted to the exact same amount as a normal taxpayer. So there's a plus benefit of 34,000 euro a year for every single student that actually gets a job. If you attribute just one-third of this surplus of extra students, this building would be paid back in 3 years. I think that is really a mind-numbing idea, because it doesn't really cost very much to design a building. It does cost nothing, to do the design brief, and this is where the value is sort of created and then delivered in the fabrication and in the operation of the building. But if you look at the levels of economy, and this is, of course, a graph that is very dynamic in its time dimension, because what you see, the idea and the design phase, that's usually less than 2 years, maybe only a half, depending on the program of the building. The fabrication of the building, that's sort of 10 times what it costs to design the building. And the operation in the very long term of a building's life cycle is much higher. But what we don't think about is that what is actually the benefits to the people that actually work in this building or live or study, and what is it? If they become, just more, efficient, productive, all the research about comfort and indoor environment, or less ill, you're dealing with a totally different scale of economy. And all that is initiated in the dialogue between the client, the architecture, and the engineering team. I think that's interesting. So what we really need to do is to go back to the building and understand, how not only how performs technically? Because that would be an important question, and that is sort of integrated in the entire debate about smart buildings. But we really need to understand how buildings perform socially, because all value is social. And that's where economic value is derived from. So we're really looking into both, you know, how do you model this? How do you design? How do you actually approach the design thinking in the process of designing it? And how do you go back and actually measure, you know, both the costs and the benefits of the environmental, social, and economic dimensions of value? This is really the approach that we're taking, and we're sort of developing the methods that we can use to document and sort of work on the value creation of this. And this is not that it's a completely new thinking. Many architects would sort of think that this is sort of integrated in the design process anyway. We've been doing all this. But nevertheless, we need to work with more precision. And I think that's where the technology part comes in, that we can actually get feedback from measurements of the building, not only in environmental terms, in energy terms, but also in social terms, and understanding how is it actually used, and what is it that the people in the building actually perceive as values. This is a pilot project done almost 10 years ago by Art Architect again. A building that was sponsored by the Velux group that wanted to do a smart building which focused on a great indoor environment, particularly daylight. It's Velux, of course. And this is a building that that is built according to the active house philosophy, where it should produce more energy than it actually uses. And this particular building also more energy than the building that was invested in the building's fabric, I mean, the embodied energy of the building. So that in the long run, over the life cycle of this building, it will be energy neutral, or it will be carbon neutral by sort of the payback of the solar cells integrated in the roof here. And they did, of course, all this, all these feedback systems, and the users of the building can sort of follow all the functionalities on this screen. And you have, as you can see, a lot of daylight coming from all parts of the of the compass, which is sort of redirected by the shape of the building. And you also have, you know, a completely a design that supports a passive way to climatize the building by sort of natural ventilation and so on for most of the year. So this has been this has actually been done 10 years ago, and they've been monitoring a couple of families living in the building, and they would have to adapt to the entire automation of this building, actually predicting, you know, because it also included weather forecasts, so the building would actually accommodate before the sun actually was covered by clouds, or, you know, before the sun broke down, broke the clouds, it would sort of begin to bzzz and create these new environmental conditions. And it did not, of course, work entirely as predicted, but it still gave important feedback and a lot of data that you can use to actually learn from as designers, but definitely also as systems engineers here. And there's a project in Copenhagen, the Nordhavn district, which is a huge urban expansion of a former industrial harbor area, where you use the entire district as a smart city energy lab. And of course, there's a lot of engineering at district level happening here. And then I have, I should not go into details at all. But they are monitoring some of the first apartments that is being done, which is retrofits of old industrial silos. You see here two silos buildings that have been converted into apartments, and they get some feedback at this. And they also need to integrate the Copenhagen International School here, which is completely covered in solar panels. So you have these this complex, you know, flow of energy and storage and things happening at the same place. It's too early to come with any conclusions about where this is going, but definitely this is a learning process. It's a Horizon 2020 project, so it has a lot of partners everywhere in Europe. And I should have liked to include just one slide after this, because actually the technology that was used here was actually used recently in a new project, the Snøhetta, the Norwegian architects. Design for Howard University's Center for Green Buildings and Cities. They've done a little research. It's a research facility, an office building. That's a conversion of an old 20s wooden building. And I'm really sorry that I can't show you any images. That was a slide that was missing. But this is a completely passive building. And the challenge is that it's as it is an office building, you need to be really accurate about the indoor environment and so on. And they have monitored everything to make sure that the thermal stack effect and so on really works. So it has seven sensors everywhere just to prove that the environmental conditions are as good as it is in a commercial building. And I think that it's thought-provoking that we need that kind of high-tech investment. They've got 7 kilometers of cabling in order to prove that environmental design, you know, architectural design makes sense. So that's my final thought. Thank you very much.